Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Gamers Inn. Come on in, pull up a chair next to the fire. It looks like you've had a long journey. I'm your host, Jocelyn, and joining me, not as always, as brand spanking new tonight, is Patrick, also known as OctanePro, because Ryan is sadly away for actual, real-life adult work.
Who does that? Jeez, real right? Work, you know?
We were actually talking off-air, and Patrick was saying, oh, I bet you get up at 10 a.m. I'm like, psh, 10 a.m. is an early day for me.
There's two things there. First, the real world, like myself, I get up at like 5:30. And second, when you have children, you don't sleep in anymore. Sleeping in's like 7:30. So I envy you a lot right now.
Yeah, that is not a world I am looking to jump into anytime soon for that exact reason. I love my sleep. My 10 a.m. wake-ups are fantastic.
Good for you.
I mean, it enables me to play games all night, which, granted, lately has pretty much been Warcraft and Legion almost exclusively. Still dabbling in Hearthstone, obviously, but yeah, Legion has been big on the things that I am playing. And fortunately, that's what you're playing too, so, you know, we could talk about that a little, but we also have Overwatch on the docket tonight, so yeah. we're gonna be mixing it up, because it's been about a month now that I've been talking about Legion, so yeah, it'll be good to mix it up a little bit. So why don't we get the Legion chat out of the way for now, and let's give the viewers a little bit of a kind of different spin on Legion, because they've heard me talk about it enough. So what are you up to in Warcraft?
This is going to be a spin that you don't expect. So
archaeology.
No, how about even worse? How about the fact that I don't play the game anymore?
Oh, no.
So I started back into WoW like a month before, maybe even a month and a half before Legion came out. And I hadn't touched WoW in years. The last time I played WoW, and the only reason I look up to the corners because I have the physical box art, was Cataclysm.
Okay.
And even Cataclysm, I was like on my way out.
So you were basically on your way out when I was on my way in.
Yeah. And so, you know, before Cataclysm came out, I was playing like PvP strictly, like was on a PvP team for Battlegrounds, was like super, like practicing multiple times a week. And that was my PvP era. And then what happened was before that, I raided a ton, like a lot, like all I did was raid. But raiding turned into, I don't have time, so it turned into PvP and Battlegrounds. And then finally, I was like, all right, I'm done with WoW. So I didn't touch WoW for a few years, whatever that comes out to be. But I did play Cataclysm, as I said. I leveled to max level, and then I stopped playing. I was like, I'm done. I'm just going to level, and then I'm done. So I hadn't played. Well, all my friends still played, and I was bored about a month and a half ago, 2 months ago. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to play, and my friends were all getting into Legion, and so they were like, hey, give it a try if you're interested. Could be fun. The PvP system is very similar to like Smite, and I used to play a lot of Smite. So,
well, wait, you used to play a lot of Smite. Are you?
I haven't played Smite in like.
Oh no!
Oh, I know. So, we'll come back to that.
Yeah. Okay.
But I was like, all right, I'll get back into it. So I went ahead and I leveled, which I can't do leveling. Like I don't do leveling. Like I put that away. Like I put that aside. But I leveled my panda horde up to I think the level was like 60 or whatever, and then I boosted it.
Yeah.
Up to 100. And then I did a bunch of PvP for like that month and a half, and then I was like, "All right, I'm bored. Like I'll wait for Legion to come out." So Legion comes out, I jump into Legion, I do the first class mission, and I'm done. Like, so talk about complete flip side. Like, the class mission was awesome. I'm a mage, yep. And I, well, was, is, possibly still am, a mage, Frost Mage, and I did the first mission and really liked it. The whole storyline is amazing, and like I can speak to that to say how cool that is. But I got to the end of it, and those of you guys that are mages and know the storyline is you go against I think it's Balthazar, in like a different realm. Well, that was when Balthazar was glitched. So if you went in, he could have 500,000 or 3 million health. Like, it just depended on your chances. So I did Balthazar like 10 times.
Oh my god. I must have had that same glitch too, because I was like, why is this guy so hard to beat? It took me like probably 10 times. Like, when I, because I did all three artifacts on my mage. So I did Arcane first, which was awful. It was a worse experience than Frost. And then I did Fire, and it took me like maybe half an hour. It was so stupid easy. And then I did Frost, and I was like, how am I supposed to kill this 3 million? But I feel like, oh no, he went back to full health every time. I think eventually I just got through it, but man, it was so hard.
Yeah, well, some of the challenges I ran into is like playing against him, you get knocked up in the air. And at first, it didn't click for me to use Slow Fall so that you don't take the damage.
You can also blink.
Yeah, you can also blink and then you go from there. So I was like, all right. So then after I got that down, I was like, all right, this is a little bit easier. And then like I started to look on Blizzard forums. This was like day one, people. And there was like threads and threads and threads of just people complaining about it, because it was just like, so some people were like, that was super easy, and some people were like, are you joking? Like, it's ridiculous. Well, lo and behold, there was a patch to hot fix it, but I did end up beating him first night, but it took me several times, and I started to notice like the health was different, like, and I was like, what, like, how is your health? So long story short, between the slow fall corrections and realizing with him it was not about like bursting down, it was very much about like longevity. Mm-hmm. You just need to find the strategy to stay alive and just burn him down regardless of how much health he had. I did it, but it took forever, and after that didn't completely turn me off, but I was just like, all right, I'm done for the night. You know, I went through the whole quest line, super cool, the storyline was amazing. That's what kind of kept me engaged, and then I signed off and never signed back on.
Oh no.
And it wasn't just like a hatred, it was just like, just before, like during my little period before Legion came out, I started playing a lot more Overwatch, and then Overwatch ranked kicked in, and like, get out of my way when it comes down to competitive games, because that is like right up my alley, and I'm just like, how can I put that aside to play WoW when it's just leveling? Like, I don't want to, like, I have friends of mine that are like, we'll level your character if you want to come do raids with us, and like, that's the only way I'm going to do it, because like, I'm not taking the time. So that's my WoW Legion story.
Oh man, so I am the total opposite of that, because I just, I can't put this game down. And to the point that my raid team is not as far along progression and gear-wise as I am.
Oh so my gosh.
I've literally leveled my second character, so I have an alt at 110 now. I am like probably 3 or 4 days away from being raid geared on two characters, a DPS and a healer. So I'm just like raring to go. And so to the point that I had content that I had to do that was questing in the raid, and my team wasn't ready. So I did LFR, and I never do LFR. LFR is like full of like angry, mean people. But I did it the first day it opened, and I think that made a difference, because it was like everyone who was really excited about raiding. And so I was like, I went in with a couple of friends, and I was lucky enough not to get a group. We only had one guy who was like, I'm totally drunk, like I'm not contributing, carry me, like, basically. And so I was like, oh well, that could be worse. It could be somebody actually like yelling at me, which is what I was, you know, thinking LFR was. So it wasn't that bad. It was actually okay, guys. I went into LFR and I lived to tell the tale.
There is a reason you are so white and pasty. It's because you play WoW so much. That is the reason.
Even if I went outside, I wouldn't tan, okay?
You would just burn. I know. Your skin's not used to the sunlight.
Even then, the sunlight in Canada is so much less potent.
That's funny. Well, it sounds like you're enjoying Legion, though, which is good. I mean, a lot of my friends are playing it. The group that I was going to like play and raid with are playing it. They have all really good things about it. But like for me, I'm like one of those people that like, kind of like what you're saying, like you get hooked on a game and you're hooked. Mm. And like you're just synced into it. And right now it's Overwatch. And I might come back to WoW, even though I can't really say I was into it that much. But you know, that's just kind of like, I have like that addictive personality in regards to like, I get addicted to things and it's just like, I'm sunk right into it. And right now it's Overwatch. Hmm. So I can definitely speak towards that.
Okay, so talk me into why I should put Warcraft down for Overwatch, because Overwatch has failed to hook me kind of time and time again.
Well, you know, if we want to take this from Roadhog's perspective and his hook, you know, No, I mean, the thing is with Overwatch, I have found that ranked has kind of reignited that kind of interest in the game. I mean, I was playing a lot of Counter-Strike GO going back a while ago, and it was great, but you had this huge skill gap, which definitely was a turnoff for a lot of people. It was for me, too. And the progression in ranked with Counter-Strike was just like, it would take forever, and no one's got time for that. And so with Overwatch recently, they overhauled their ranking system to make it almost identical to StarCraft II.
Oh, okay.
So now you kind of have your bronze.
That's a ranked ladder that I like. Because yes. I know, like, Hearthstone, don't get me started on the Hearthstone ladder, and that's the only ladder that I really play competitively on.
Yeah.
So, but I know, like, even though I'm, you know, Bronze League hero for life, that StarCraft 2 ladder, that makes sense to me. I like that. I like to be able to kind of have an identity within a game to say, like, sure. I am a rank blah player, whatever that is. But yeah, StarCraft, I was never getting above bronze. But I feel like Overwatch is something I could strive for. And the Overwatch ladder, at least in Season 1, and why it didn't really hook me, is I had no idea what the number meant. And I actually had the whole ladder switched, because in Hearthstone, a lower number was better. But in Overwatch, like, a higher number was better. So, like, I saw people saying, like, oh, I'm, like, a level 70. I'm like, I'm, like, 49, so that's, like, way better than you.
Yeah.
Turns out, no, it's not.
And that's one of the things where, like, Blizzard's starting to do a really good job of almost, you know, crossing their universes, not from a content perspective, but from things they learn from one to the other. So, you know, in that situation, StarCraft II kind of rolling over into this situation. And that was a big one they spoke about when they came out with, or they were just going to come out with the new ranking system, because they do a gap between seasons, which I really like. And I hate about other games where, like, they're like, oh, a ranked season is 365 days. That's how Smite is. Mm. And it's absurd. And, like, Overwatch is, like, 6 weeks. And then it's like, okay, you have a month off, and then we start back up 6 weeks again. So during the downtime, they came out with a video introducing the fact that that was a major problem they were seeing. Where, like, it was all about numbers, and there wasn't that value behind it. So they moved to this new system where there still is numbers, but they're numbers that define your rank, and your rank is directly reflected. So, like, you go into a game, you know, you can see not necessarily their individual numeric rank, but just what league they're in, which is great. And so that has kind of pulled me back into it, too, just from my StarCraft II passions in the past, where, you know, you get to see what rank you are. And the other thing there, too, is that I have found with Overwatch that you need to be playing it with other people. It is not a game you could just jump in, like WoW, for example, and just play. You can, but, you know, with WoW, you know, you kind of do your raids or an instance or whatever. But with this game, with Overwatch, it actually really does come down to playing with friends, because, like, you have 10 placement matches to do in ranked for Overwatch. And I, unfortunately, made the mistake of doing them all solo queue.
See, and you would I feel like I did it all solo queue, and that was way better.
Oh, it was so bad.
The ones that I did, I actually think I played two of them with you. And
That must have been season one.
It was season one. Yeah, it was season one. Yeah. So I think I did two or maybe three with you, and I think we lost all three because I felt like you guys were up here and I was down here, and I was getting pulled into, even though, like, it was averaging, I was still playing against people that were way above my skill level, and I'm like, now I've just tanked three of my games.
I can understand where you come from there. In the new rank system, it's nice because, like, I've been playing with a lot. Like, I found that you got to play with someone else because you can at least rely on one other person's skill level. Whereas when you go in solo queue, you kind of can't rely on anybody because you can't rely on them from a skill level perspective. And I found, one, it's so much more fun. And, like, the factor of having everyone in a voice chat is just so enjoyable. You know, so that actually works out really well. But what I have found a lot of fun recently is I have a lot of friends that are just getting into ranked, and they're in placement matches. Well, we can queue together and go into a match, and it does an amazing job matching us up. Like, I'll go in with a friend or two that are still in placement, and our team will be made up of all placement people and me. And then on the other team, it'll be all placement people and then one person. Like, the accuracy of it is so close now of the ranking system and the averages that I've been really happy with it. And the skill gap, like,
So when did the season start? Because I'm wondering if that's just a byproduct of so many people doing their placement matches all at once, or
not necessarily. I would say 3 weeks ago, maybe.
Okay, so like halfway through now in a 6 week
season.
Yeah,
yeah, and it's pretty well established at this point, which has been really, really nice. So that is kind of what I've been doing a lot of, and I don't know that I can say anything of like, hey, this is the main number one reason to jump into Overwatch, but I'm just having a ton of fun with it right now. Everything just seems super balanced, and the one thing that pulls me back into the game time and time again is the balance, because constantly we'll have games where it's 99% to zero, and then you come back and you end up beating the other team, or 99 to 99, and then it's neck and neck for like 5 minutes until someone wins. And those are the types of situations where you get pulled back into it. And that same thing applies in all games, though. Like, wow, like, you're grinding a raid boss all night long, and then you finally take that raid boss down. You know, that's what pulls you back into the game. So I've been really, really enjoying it and been very happy with it thus far.
That's good, because I know, like I said, I haven't actually played Overwatch since the launch of the new map. So I guess, actually, probably even before that announcement. So I think the last time I played, Anna had just been added as a hero.
Okay.
So it's been a long time. I definitely haven't played in the competitive season two stuff. So I think I did my placement matches a few days before season one ended. It was like right near the end. And I did my placement matches just to kind of like see how I would do, because I didn't realize when they announced competitive mode, I was like, oh, this is going to be great. I just wonder how I am at Overwatch. I feel like I'm kind of okay. So, you know, let's put a number to that. And then you had to be level 25, and I was like level 9. So I had to play a whole lot before I even had the chance to do my placement. Then I did my placement, and I was kind of middle of the road. Like I said, I think I was 49 or 51 or something in the middle. Anyways, and so, yeah, and even then, I forgot to turn off my, my sub notifications.
Bring it on!
Thanks, Afro Horsey. I didn't even think that I turned those back on again, but apparently. Thanks.
That's funny.
Oh my God. That's happened in like the last, like two or three of my last podcasts. I need to be more careful about that. Anyways.
That's okay.
Oh man.
And I like how the viewer in chat was like, I asked, you know, like I'm sorry.
I wasn't reading chat. I was so worried. Just like recapping my Overwatch experience. I was like tunnel vision.
That's right.
But yeah, I mean, totally fine.
Yeah, I know. When Anna came out, Anna wasn't exactly. There were a lot of things that didn't work about her, and they made a bunch of changes. And now she's actually viable, which is pretty cool. As almost a second healer, and her ultimate is something that is pretty decently relied upon and is really good in the game. So that's kind of been nice, because she was very questionable at the start as a sniper that has no mobility. Like the other ones do. So
yeah.
And then it's the new map you're talking about, because it came out with a new one in season two called I think it's called Eichewald. It's like a very like castle-esque type of looking one.
Yes, that's the one. That's like the home of Reinhardt's people or
it's
something.
So cool. It is such a cool map. It is like if you like to play gunslingers or super aggressive characters, there's so many little like passageways and alleys and steps going up and down. It's really cool. So I've been very happy with Overwatch recently, and I find myself going to it time and time again because I can jump in for 30 minutes, play a game, and be done with it. It's not something I have to commit to for several hours at a time to make progress.
So let me ask you this then. Are you playing a lot of these games, Warcraft and Overwatch, basically as a time filler until we get all our new stuff in the fall? Because we're coming up on like October, November. Most of our big releases are going to be November. Is there any specific thing that you're looking at coming out in the next couple of months that's going to pull you away from the Overwatch Blizzard experience?
I really hope not, to be honest with you. I'm the type, you know, we've known each other for a few years now. And like, I'm the type of person where like, when I played Smite, like, 4 years, get out of my way. That's the only game I played. Like, and
this
I would tell people,
I can't believe you're not playing it right now. That blows my mind.
Yeah, like I would tell people, like I'm not interested in that game. I'm playing Smite, and it's like you can play other games. Like, nope,
no,
one game, nope, that's it. So, So, yeah, there's nothing particular at this time. I'm not the type of person that, like, and there's all different types of gamers out there. And the gamer that I am is just, when I get hooked, as we talked about earlier, that's what I sink my teeth into, and I stay with it for quite some time. I mean, you know, for me, it was StarCraft II for years and years and years through the expansions, and then it was on to Smite. And before even StarCraft II, it was WoW, but then it was into Smite, as I said. And then from Smite, you know, it kind of fizzled out. It was heavy into, like, Counter-Strike. And then from there, it was, you know, back into, and it was into Overwatch. So kind of a little bit of everything. But I think Overwatch will last me for a while. It's kind of weird because it's like a mix of universes in my mind. Like, it's that first-person shooter Counter-Strike that I've been playing since I was in elementary school. And then on the other end of it, it's got very much that Blizzard universe-esque feel to it. Mm-hmm. So it's Blizzard does a good job at feeding our addiction. So that's probably where I'll sit for a while. What about you? Is there anything coming up here that you're like, you know, that's going to be your game?
I'm not even that sure. I mean, there's the new Zelda, but that's been pushed. There's Mass Effect, but that's been pushed. So I feel like all of my big ones have kind of been pushed to next year, and they're all saying kind of like March 2017. So I feel like that's going to be a big time for me, but I am excited about Battlefield 1. I think that that's something that's going to pull me away from the Blizzard universe, at least temporarily I'll probably get a good month or so of play of that, I think. Maybe.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty sweet. I have looked at Battlefield here and there. I feel like it's, if you're a Battlefield fangirl, then like you kind of follow that franchise a lot and you jump in and out of their games in between them. But like I never like got into the Battlefield franchise at all, so there's nothing that like pulls me into it. Like from an outsider's perspective, it's like, oh, another first person shooter. Well, cool.
Well, see, and I was never into Battlefield either. I was a Call of Duty girl. But now Call of Duty is going to space, and I'm kind of like, whereas Battlefield 1 is taking the complete opposite approach and going back in time, back to World War 1. So I'm kind of like, I kind of feel that a little bit more than I feel the whole, you know, like going up into space, like pew, 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 anti-gravity, what's up? But yeah, no, flying a spaceship, not my thing. But like, I think the whole... I'm hoping some sort of trench warfare, because if they don't do trench warfare, that would be really weird. But, you know, like just that kind of like old school type warfare stuff, I think is going to be really neat. So I'm looking forward to not so much multiplayer, but at least playing through the story of Battlefield 1, I think is going to be really interesting. So that's the one I'm looking forward to that hasn't been pushed so far. Yeah. Knock on wood.
Absolutely. No, but, I think that makes sense.
Yeah.
So to fill you in on Smite. So those of you guys that aren't familiar, I've been playing Smite since since early alpha, like when you loaded up the game and it didn't last very long at all because the servers were crashed. And I played it through alpha, through beta, when it launched, and I was heavily involved in the scene, did two podcasts for Smite. I've worked at Hi-Rez's World Championships for the multiple years, which I'm still going to this year. They asked me to go out and do production this year, which will be my fourth year, yeah. I had to look around because I got all the Smite posters, so I needed to figure out how many of them.
It totally looked like you were yelling at an assistant off camera. Like, fourth year? Yeah, fourth year.
Check, four. Now, in my basement, I have posters for every year that I've been to, and they're framed. And so there's a launch tournament, and then there is the 1 year, then another year, and then another post. Anyways, 4 years. So, I have done a lot in the Smite scene, and I kind of got to a point where I got burnt out from it. And I think that happens with everyone. The same thing happened with me with StarCraft 2. And that was kind of – with Smite, it was kind of – and I was also streaming, if I didn't mention it, and content creation on YouTube. And I kind of got to the point where I was just like, I need a break. And it wasn't just from Smite. It was just from content creation, from streaming. I was coming home every day and putting in like – 7 hours of streaming after I worked a 9-hour day on top of taking care of a kid and having being a husband. And so I kind of decided like, hey, like I have been doing this for 5 years, like 5 years. And like, I didn't have a huge following. It was a decent following, but not a huge following, but a decent enough where I had partnership with Twitch and YouTube, and I was working with Hi-Rez and stuff. So it was kind of cool, but there wasn't a sustainability and there was no growth for me. It was just kind of a constant. And it's hard to make those decisions as, like, gaming is a passion and, like, content creation is a passion and a hobby. But I finally, you know, I just needed to say, hey, I'm done. Like, so I decided to, you know, pack up shop. You know, I made a long post on Reddit in the Smite community and just kind of said, here's why I'm doing it. And, you know, it was not only for just getting burnt out. It was also just because, like, my wife was expecting our daughter. So I was like, all right, I'm going to have two kids running around now. And I wanted to further my career in a direction that I would like it, which I have. And on top of that, like, also for health reasons, like, I had gained some weight since, you know, over the last 5 years. And I was like, I want to get back in shape. So hence why you see a bike behind me. My last ride was like 30 some miles that I did.
Nice.
And so, like, yeah, so it was kind of a lot of things that came together, but it was time to cut ties with Smite. Like, it was time to move on. It was time to do something different. So I literally, like, stopped playing Smite, stopped streaming, stopped content creation, stopped it all, but I still gamed. Like, and that's when I kind of jumped onto Overwatch and was like, huh, I'm going to play Overwatch just because, you know, like, and I could jump on for a half hour, jump off. I could exit a game if I needed to, as long as it's not ranked and not be punished for it. So that's kind of where Smite was and where it is now. And now I'm still gaming. It's not as heavily, you know, I might game a few hours a night each week. I'm still doing content creation, but that's going a different direction now. It's more car related. When I talked about my career earlier, I decided that I wanted to invest more in my career. And for the longest time, I wanted to mix my background in IT with gaming, and I wanted to try to get an in with a publisher, and High Res is who I thought I could do, and that just never ended up working out. It never took off. And so my second passion behind gaming is cars and the car industry. Well, I ended up moving from my job that I was a manager, now I work as a director at a high performance parts manufacturer in the automotive industry. So passions now meeting my day-to-day career. So that's kind
of
where
the way to do it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And there's different ways to do it. You know, like Jocelyn, you know, you're going ahead and doing your passion. You know, I know just like Garrett, like the same thing, like different avenue, different parts in life. You know, me, two kids, wife, house payment. Can't really say, hey, guys,
responsibilities.
Can't really say, hey, guys, I'm quitting life and I'm going to stay at home and do podcasts and gaming. Not that I don't think that is awesome, because like I have seen that, and like, it's awesome. I can't say I've lived it, but I've seen a lot of it. So yes, that being said, you know, as I'm gaming, I'm doing content in the car industry now more, which fits kind of what I'm doing. And so still doing YouTube videos and stuff like that, which I enjoy doing. So yeah, that's kind of why life has come full circle all of a sudden.
And why Overwatch and no Smite? Well, I've got to say, yes. I mean, I totally understand, because I know obviously Smite is not that flexible, and you being super competitive, I mean, sometimes Smite queues can take 30 to 45 minutes, so I'm not surprised Overwatch, and it's like instantaneous, and it's drop if you need to, and it's going to be in and out in a couple of minutes sort of thing is much more appealing to kind of like a unpredictable lifestyle that is when you have kids, right? So
Yep.
Yeah, that's. I think Blizzard has just hit the nail on the head now with all of their gamers are kind of aging to the point, you know, everyone who got in as a teenager in Warcraft is now doing all these like real life adulting things. And
you
can't
act
sit
like,
for
you
hours
act like,
a day.
You act like you're a teenager or something.
Like, I live like doing, I'm a teenager, dude.
You do. You really do. A teenager that can drink.
Yes,
know, you're
exactly. I've got it all figured out.
Oh my word. It's so funny though, because Blizzard is like a drug dealer. Like all, like they provide you your addiction and they hook you in young.
Yes,
and like
absolutely,
that's what it is. Like their target market is like, like that middle school, high school age. Because when you get addicted, then it follows you all the way through. Like, man, I started in StarCraft 1 originally, and that was when you could copy the game CD and give it to your friends and you could play together. Like, there was none of this, like, Battle.net account. Like, oh, I'm sorry, Battle.net was there, but it didn't have any tie-in directly with your key. So, like, one person could buy the game and 50 people later could still be playing the game together. And now look at it. Now it's years later and, like, multiple games later, we're still playing Blizzard games. Like, they are drug dealers.
Well, speaking of drinking and drugs, I need to remind everybody to go to etch.amove.tv where you can get super fancy pint glasses with the Gamers In logo on them, as well as other A-Move shows like The Angry Chicken and Into the Nexus. So check that out. You can also go to shirts.amove.tv to get some pretty fancy shirts of all your favorite shows. That's going to bring us into our topic of the week this week, where we are talking about putting the sports in esports. We've had a couple of different stories... laughing at me right now.
That transition was so lame, but it was good.
Shut up.
it felt newscasted. It was very newscast. Well, that brings it. Please continue.
Oh man, so we've had a couple of different stories break this past week with different, for some reason, specifically NBA-focused, either former players, team owners, or in one case, a team itself, actually purchasing esports organizations. So the first story we've got here is Axiomatic Esports, which is a few different investors, including Magic Johnson, as well as co-owners of the Golden State Warriors and the Washington Wizards, are buying a majority share in Team Liquid. And then we had the Philadelphia 76ers, the actual team themselves, just straight out bought Dignitas and Apex. So they have merged them together into just being Team Dignitas, and they're going to be competing in League of Legends, Overwatch, Counter-Strike, Heroes of the Storm, and Smite. Not Hearthstone, though, which kind of makes me sad, but...
So
what do you think, where do you think that this kind of sudden interest and therefore like big dollar investment comes from, like traditional sports into esports? Where do you think that interest kind of came from, started?
Well, first off, it's nuts that a lot of this is blossoming from like the NBA scene.
Yeah.
It's just like so odd because like I feel like, and some people are going to hate me, but I feel like the NBA is kind of like one of those like fizzling sports in general. But it's just odd to me to find that all of a sudden, like, all these, like, players are like, I got money. Let's throw it into gaming. Not to say, I mean, okay, it's one of those things where in today's society, a lot of your traditional jocks are also gamers. Like, the whole nostalgia around, like, oh, gamers are nerds and it's dorky not to do that. Like, that doesn't, I feel like that doesn't exist anymore. Like, that is
definitely
on its
not as much as it did when we grew up. Yeah,
no,
for sure.
not at all. I mean, like, I was a jock in high school, but I gamed more than, like, anything. Like, but it was just one of those things where it's one of the, there's so many people that are playing video games now from a mobile level all the way up to consoles and into PC games where there's that connection there. And I think that's where that's coming from, where a lot of these NBA players are, granted, a lot of them talked about are retired. But a lot of them, you know, that are still that aren't retired, they're like mid 20s and like, they're like, can't say mid, I'm not mid 20s anymore, but I'm 31. All right. So like, I can understand that. Like that's when you're gaming a lot. And so I can see where that's coming from, but to kind of wrap this up a little bit here, you ask, like, where all of a sudden this comes from, and the only thing I can really put my finger on is about a year ago at the Smite World Championship, I was at the Smite World Championship, and there were groups of people coming along getting backstage tours of the production setup. Well, a group of them were from Turner Esports, and those of you guys not familiar, Turner Esports, Turner itself is one of the largest television broadcasting companies in the world. They own multiple channels, major channels that are out there. And they were getting tours of the facility to look at the production setup and what all was involved here. Now, skipping ahead, Turner Esports launched an arena in Atlanta, and all its focus was, Turner Esports was just a gaming esports focus of Turner, and they planned to put it on television every Friday night, and it was Counter-Strike's E-League. Counter-Strike being one of the top few largest esports in the world. All of a sudden, it was like traditional broadcasting meets gaming, and Turner Esports was at the head of it. Well, skipping ahead, E-League has finished up, and you know, now there's more conversations as to what else they're going to be hosting there. And I forget what I heard, what game they're going to be doing there other than Counter-Strike coming up. Oh, you know what? No, it was Overwatch. Overwatch and their world championships, whatever, will be there. And the thing is, it's like all of a sudden, like that stuff is on television on Friday nights, you know, it's on live television.
Heroes of the Dorm.
Yes,
which was
exactly.
on, ESPN.
Yep.
Well, and ESPN2, which apparently that's a big distinction.
Yeah. No, absolutely. But it's sort of, and it's not like, okay, esports on television has caused this to happen. But what has occurred is it started to make this more well known, especially in the United States, of just like the scene and the money that's in the scene. And then Shaquille O'Neal was used for advertising for E-League. And I think what's where a lot of this is starting to wrap around. Granted, Shaquille O'Neal then had already owned NRG. NRG was owned by him and a Yankees player. I'm blanking on his name, and one other gentleman. And that was huge to see. Like that was kind of those were like the first three guys to start to invest that. So it's weird. This whole like trickle effect is occurring. And what's happening now? You know what is going on now? It's just nuts that this is occurring. I'm hoping it's not a hipster phase. Like it's not a, hey, this is what all the other esports athletes are doing that have millions of dollars that get paid $80 million a year to do nothing but shoot a ball into a hoop. But it's just, they have all this money. So like they're just dumping it into esports and I'm all for it. I'm excited to see where it goes. What are your thoughts on it? I mean, there's quite a lot going on there.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, it's not so much a big story, I think, about the majority share in Team Liquid. I think that that's great, but they're still keeping on, you know, their same owners and advisors and everything else. Like, nothing's really changing in terms of the actual structure of Team Liquid. They just, you know, now own a majority share. I think, really, the 76ers is the bigger story to kind of, you know, buy these two esports teams, combine them, create a new one. And I'm really interested to see what they do going forward, because I think one of the biggest problems, one of the biggest things holding esports back just in general, is that they tend to cater to existing audiences as opposed to trying to kind of give it mass appeal. And oftentimes that means that they kind of devolve into the lowest common denominator stuff with all the bad stuff that happens in Twitch chat and everything else. Yeah. And I feel like a lot of that is due to the fact that we don't have kind of like mentor figures. We don't really have anyone, because esports is so new, it's hard to have a lot of these people that actually, you know, have experience and know what they're doing and can kind of show the athletes how to behave and how to kind of manage and how to promote and, you know, all these other skills. They're lacking in a lot of esports organizations. So to see a professional sports team come in with money and experience and everything else and say, hey guys, we're going to show you how to do this shit, I feel like this is going to have a really positive impact, and it's going to allow esports to take the step to the next level and kind of appeal to a wider audience. And then, you know, like they're going to be able to do things like have shows every Friday night, and it's going to be, you know, like players who, even though they are 16 to 25, acting as professionals, acting and conducting themselves properly and having people take them seriously. So I think that that's the bigger story here, is the 76ers taking over an existing esports team.
Yeah, I mean, the big one there, too, that you briefly touched on is definitely the money factor. Those of you guys that aren't as familiar, I did manage a esports organization for about a year and a half, and they were involved in Counter-Strike and Smite, and there was also some fighting games as well. The big factor is money there, and having these investors dropping millions of dollars into esports organization is like a significant change, because traditionally it came down to sponsors. And most of the time when you have sponsors, most of them are not straight up cash sponsors. It's mostly like product or some type of relationship sponsor. But now this is interesting, because instead of like, okay, we need to get the big sponsors, which is really difficult to do, except if you're overseas in like Korea or Europe, you know, getting sponsors like Samsung or, Coca-Cola, whatever, you know, it's really hard in the States to get that. You're getting a lot of little sponsors that just cover your operating cost. So you can't treat the players the way they should be treated.
Right.
Now that you have these big investors coming in and you're like, here's money. Oh, by the way, this is how you really treat athletes. And it's not just like that the organization hasn't wanted to do that, but it all comes down to money. I mean, money makes the world turn. And at this point, you know, being able to say, okay, you're an esports athlete. Okay, great. We can pay you salary, which is almost a thing that's unheard of in the scene.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, it's like, well, They need nutritionists. They need, gym trainers. You know, they need, you know, there's a whole bunch of needs that they have. They can hook them up in the way that you haven't been able to, so that these esports athletes stick around. Because a lot of times people just come and go, you know, because it's like, oh, sorry, I can't afford this. I'm in college right now. I can't afford to be spending 8 hours a night playing this game. Well, now if you're like, well, we could pay you, you know, $5,000 a month. Okay, I can do it. You know, like, we'll make it work type of deal. So those opportunities are, I think the flow of cash is definitely quite significantly different now.
Yeah, and I think I totally had a point and it's gone, but something about salaries. Oh, okay. Basically, the fact that, like you mentioned, the big influx of money allowing players to actually pull a salary, that's really important too, because I know that's why one specific team that had some of the best players in Hearthstone actually ended up folding was Hearthlytics. And basically, they weren't making enough through sponsors to pay the players a high enough salary. And then so therefore, to try to attract more more advertising dollars, more interest in their team and everything else, the players were required not only to focus on actually being good at their sport, which is what they should be focused on, but also content creation. And content creation is not easy. And I find like a lot of the time, like, that doesn't necessarily come down just to streaming often. And I'm not saying that this is specific to Hearthlytics. I'm just saying in general, players are expected to do things like, after they stream, maybe they do like a deck list, you know, like a strategy guide, or, you know, like all these things that then involve like video editing. And the more things that they have to do like that, that are taking them away from the sport, the less they're going to perform. And that's really not what you want. You want your players to be able to focus on doing the best that they possibly can in the game that they play, regardless of whether that is, you know, football or basketball or Counter-Strike. You know, whatever it is, you want them to be able to focus on their game, and that's it. That's one of the big things that you see professional athletes talking about all the time, is focus on the game. And for the longest time now, people who are athletes in esports have not been able to do that. So I think this huge influx of money and the fact that they're going to be able to say, all right, here's your salaries, do your job, I think that's a huge step. Huge, huge step for esports.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that was kind of the struggle. You definitely, you know, you hit the nail right on the head there regarding, you know, what players run into, because running an esports organization early on, that was kind of the thing. It was like, okay, you're going to play, but we need you to create content to create traffic, because the traffic is what gets sponsors. Winning tournaments is great, but at the end of the day, unless you're right in front of hundreds of thousands of people with a
giant logo on your chest,
giant logo on your chest, that's not really accomplishing anything. Like, and the streaming,
which
doesn't
is crazy
really...
and backwards. Like, you win this giant tournament, and you know, like, oh well, that doesn't actually mean anything. Go on Twitch for 10 hours a day.
Yeah,
like...
I mean that's the thing. It, with sponsors, it's all about impact, and it's all about what type of impact they get from having you as a sponsor. So, like, you know, are they getting increased views? Do you have enough influence in a scene that if you jump on a stream and you're drinking Monster, people go ahead and pick up a Monster because they want to be like you? Well, unless you're getting, you know, thousands, tens of thousands of viewers, no. So, like, those are things that matter to sponsors. Sponsors are not like, I want to throw money at you because I got money to blow. That's not smart business. Like, no one does that. Like, you know, not unless you're Shaquille O'Neal with millions of dollars and you're like, I don't know what to do with my money. What should I do with it? All right, I'm going to throw it at esports. Like, that doesn't happen. That's not how sponsors work. That's, you know, they need to see a return on investment, an ROI. So, like, for them, that's where they want to see it. And so that's where that was the biggest deal. It was like, but having players now at some of these teams that can say, well, I can focus on winning and I don't have to worry about content creation, how many tweets I make a month, how many YouTube posts I make a month. Now, granted, at the end of the day, the Twitter post, the YouTube post, the Instagram post, streaming on Twitch, those are all things that will help grow your individual brand. Grow the individual Josh Plays brand. Like, that helps you grow your brand, so when things fall apart on your esports team, you can still turn around and be making some type of income at the end of the day. That's kind of your fallback. If you can grow your own scene to the point where you can financially, you know, afford
yourself,
then you're good. You know, that works out perfect. How cool would it be to not have to work for anyone but yourself? So, like, that's kind of the nice thing there. So I think those are big steps for the competitive scene.
I agree. And that was a great conversation. I was like, because I know when I first asked Octane to come on, he's like, oh, do you want me to talk as like an inside stuff and like really adapt? Like, no, just like, we'll just sit back and chat. You know, GamerZen's really laid back. And that was awesome, dude. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. Like, honestly, that was great. So I think that's probably where we're going to wrap it up. So why don't you tell everyone where they can find you on the internet, if they can even find you on the internet
now.
You
can find me. So you can find me on Twitter. Same as what's on screen right now for the audio podcast listeners. It's OctanePro, and then going back to my roots, SCII. And that is on Twitter, that is on Periscope, that is on Instagram, and that is on YouTube. And the reason I say Periscope is because every once in a while I like to do live Periscopes, if it's from esports events or whatever, or car events. Twitter, I'm constantly posting there. I'm putting out 3 videos a week now regarding daily vlog type of stuff. So like, hey, do life with me, or it's car related. And that's 3 times a week. Video will be out tomorrow. And so that was YouTube, Twitter. Yeah. So whatever. OctanePro, SCII. I even still have a stream. Maybe someday I'll come back to it if you want to follow me there. But yes, so that's where you can follow me on pretty much every outlet available.
Awesome. Thank you so much for joining me. This is a really, really fun show. And I very much appreciate your insight into all this esports stuff, because you were so involved with Smite for so long. I feel like you're an expert opinion.
I don't know about that, but I'll take the compliment.
All right, guys, if you'd like to visit us on the web, you can do so at gamersinpodcast.com. You can also find us on amove.tv, along with other fabulous podcasts, including The Angry Nerd, Into the Nexus, Overwatchers, and The Angry Chicken. You can follow us on Twitter. You can find me, Jocelyn, Joss Plays. Ryan is at R. Murphy. And don't forget to follow the show at The Gamers Inn. The video versions of all our episodes can be found on our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/amovetv. You can also find the show on Facebook and Google+. If you'd like to email the show and let us know what you think about traditional sports getting into esports, you can do so at info@gamersinpodcast.com. So thanks for staying at The Gamers Inn. Remember, tune in next week. Bye, everybody.
Later.